thank you. We had a long day. I am between you and your cocktail dinner. I'm going to talk about a difficult subject. And still, you're all here. Okay. Who's familiar with antifragility? I only see one hand. Okay. So I've got some work to do here. And who is familiar with this beast? Hydra, right. And what happens if you cut off a head of Hydra? Immediately, two heads grow back. Immediately. So with every attack, it becomes stronger, actually. And so you could actually say that Hydra was anti-fragile avant la lettre. Did you hear me speak French?
Yeah, right.
It just right happened. Few seconds about myself. The upper part is about my IT training. Lower part is about helping organizations finding markets with customers, but without competition. And then we're talking about the so-called blue oceans. And I'm doing some research. And one of the research aspects that I do is about support staff in agile and DevOps environments. Maybe you recognize that if you roll out agile or DevOps in an organization, is control and HR and compliance, will they be happy? You don't have any experience with that? Normally, when you start with agile and DevOps in an organization, control is not happy, HR is not happy, compliance is not happy. That's what happens. And then we are trying to bring those worlds more together, actually. We talked about risk, about antifragility in disruptive times. Risks. What are indicators that your industry is at risk? And please count with me. How much waste is there in your industry? Like slow processes and redundant steps. You already have one? How much money do you earn from opacity? Is it easy for customers to compare your product with the product of competitors? Maybe a two. And to what extent do you push standard products through the throat of your customers while they might like a customized version? And some aggravating factors, the closer to the customer, the more vulnerable you are, and the simpler the product, the lower the barrier for competitors to enter your market. Who counted up to five aspects, five factors? Nobody? Four? Three? Four? Even four? In what industry are you?
I'd rather not tell.
Okay. Anybody with three? I was just curious about the industries, actually. But for instance, it could be about banking. It could be about insurance. It could be about retail. All those industries are actually at risk. And why is disruption so dangerous? Because evolution, technical evolution, is not following the path in the lower left corner, like a little bit to the left and a little bit to the right. No, it is actually following the path in the lower right corner. So pressure is building up to the right or building up to the left, but nothing is happening yet. Pressure is building up. More technological advancements. More pressure is building up, but nothing happens until a particular point in time, like here, and then finally it shifts to the left. And all the time it was just pressure building up. But you would say, okay, nothing can happen because we got risk management. Risk management. Well, actually, Taleb, the writer of the book, calls it risk, not risk management, but risk theater. Because he says you only can take into account the risks that you know, and you cannot take into account the risks that you don't know. So black swans and all that, you cannot take them into account. So risk management, according to him, is just risk theater. So the man who is saying this is Nassim Nicholas Taleb, the writer, the author of the book Anti-Fragile. This is that particular book. I would ask who has read this book, but there were only a few people who were aware of the fact what anti-fragility was, so I think I don't have to ask that. But if you look at what is on the cover of the book, enduring volatility is one thing, what about benefiting from it? The ultimate model to aspire, actually. And second, things that gain from disorder. So anti-fragile systems and anti-fragile organizations, they like disorder. And what is disorder? What is disorder in IT? It's actually all the things that we do all day, like changing existing functionality, implementing new requirements, supporting new business opportunities, and of course also a lot of unintended ways that our users are using our systems. All those things generate disorder. And when we talk about anti-fragility, until 2012, we only had two words which were the opposite of fragile, and that was actually robust and resilient. And since 2012, that was the year in which Taleb wrote the book, we got this new word, anti-fragile. Now, what is the difference between those four things? Fragile systems actually deteriorate from the very beginning. The moment they exist, they begin to deteriorate. A robust system will remain steady for a long time until it reaches a point that it encounters a black swan, and then it will collapse. A resilient system will recover to the level that it was originally, but it will not become better than it was. And an anti-fragile system will even become better than it was in the beginning. So it really gains from disorder. Let me give you some examples. This is fragile, obvious. But this is also fragile. Why is the Scrum framework fragile? Any idea? Who? Because if you do Scrum Sec, you talk about a potentially shippable increment, and you don't put it to the test, you don't put it to production, so you're accumulating changes, so you're accumulating risk, so and that's in fact fragile. So when you combine Agile and Scrum with DevOps, then in the end it becomes more anti-fragile, as we will see in a few moments. This is robust, the beast from Obama. Never seen Trump in this vehicle, but okay. This is robust in IT, right? does anyone anyone recognize this beast? Sorry? The Phoenix, right. The Phoenix, it rises from its ashes, but it will never get better than it was. It will become just the same beast as it was, actually. And this is a cockpit from the Airbus 380, and that's actually a resilient system. Aircrafts are resilient. If one electrical system fails, there's a backup electrical system. If both electrical systems fail, there is a backup vacuum system or a backup hydraulic system or whatever. So they are really resilient. Anti-fragile, we already saw the beast, Hydra. And this is actually anti-fragile NRT. Who's familiar with the Chaos Monkey? No, more than 50% of the people. Yeah, Chaos Monkey introduces random errors in systems, and between 9 o'clock in the morning and 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And then engineers have to, if the system doesn't respond in the right way, the engineers will have to repair it. And you also have a latency monkey introducing artificial latency, it really works because Netflix, who invented the chaos monkey had to invent a chaos gorilla because they became immune to the chaos monkey. So it really works. And altogether, they put it into a simian army. And, well, you might know that simian army is open source. You can download it, and you can release it in your own production environment, because that's what Netflix does. There's one other thing to it, and that's it. An anti-fragile layer, because we just watched that a single aircraft is resilient, but the aircraft industry is anti-fragile, because it learns from every failure and every crash. And so the aircraft industry as a whole becomes better by means of crashes and errors. So, how to get more anti-fragile? One of the things we already now discovered is chaos engineering. That's important to become more anti-fragile. What else? Well, to discover that, we need a little math. It's 5 minutes past six. Are you ready for some heavy stuff? No. No, don't worry. They look like this. So we have a variable, and this is actually the graphs that Taleb uses in his book. He talks about gain and pain, and he talks about a variable. And not about the linear stuff like this. For instance, this could be your salary, the higher the better, right? Or maybe like this, this could be the number of defects you have to handle. The more defects you have to handle, the unhappier you get. That's not interesting. What is interesting for anti-fragility is when there is asymmetry. And asymmetry, it actually says that anything that has more upside than downside from random events and shocks is anti-fragile. The reverse is fragile. And to judge that, this is actually one of the most important definitions in the book, to judge that, the anti-fragility of a system or an organization, is to ask whether it is accelerating towards harm or benefit, toward pain or gain. So it might look like this. So if this variable, if you decrease that variable, there's only generated a little bit of gain. But if you increase the variable, it rushes towards pain. The other way around, if you increase this variable, it generates just a little bit of pain. But if you decrease the variable, it rushes towards gain. So what would this be? Is this a fragile or an anti-fragile example? Fragile, right. Whatever happens, the variable, decrease or increase, in all cases, it goes down, it rushes towards pain. And then we have this one, the right one, and that's, of course, the anti-fragile one. So whatever happens, variable up or down, doesn't matter, in all cases, you end up towards the gain. But there is a little trick to it, because you don't know if you are at the blue dot or maybe at the yellow dot. So you have to experiment where you are with that particular variable. To remember that, just remember that the frown is the fragile one and the smile is the anti-fragile one. An IT example, for instance, this one. Number of deployments per month. Suppose you don't deploy at all. You have some system from 20 years ago. It doesn't need any changes, and you're happy. But as soon as you are starting to deploy changes in that very old system, you get very unhappy. But as soon as you start increasing that number of deployments per month, for instance, once a month, or maybe twice a month, or once a week, or once a day, the more you increase that, the easier it will get in the end. So you could actually say that continuous deployment is anti-fragile. And that's correct, because it doesn't matter. When you decrease the number of deployments, you still remain happy. But when you increase it again, it doesn't matter. You will remain happy, because you do it so often. You got it all automated. Everything works smooth. And if you encountered some problem, you will be able to solve that. The other way around, another IT example. The number of tasks coordinated in a software project. Suppose you don't coordinate anything. Left side, blue dot. So there will be chaos. You will not be happy. As soon as you start coordinating things, you will get happier. The number of tasks in that project, you will get happier. But software projects, as always, they tend to grow too big, too large. And when they get too big, especially software projects, in the end, you will rush towards pain again. So you can also say that software projects are fragile, and they are. So that is one of the aspects of asymmetry. The second one is optionality. If you read this particular sentence, definition of an option is a contract which gives the buyer the right, but not the obligation to do something. I think that most of you now think at something financial, right? But there's a lot of other options that are not financial, and they are, in most cases, they are not expensive, or maybe they are very cheap, or they are maybe free. And then you could think of something like this, the Unicorn Club, the club of all the companies that are worth more than $1 billion. And all these unicorns, they used a particular option at a particular point in time, and then, well, that was the right time for that particular option, and they became actually a unicorn. And you see that at the right of the screen, that there become more and more unicorns. So this is actually about optionality. And we also know that, of course, from the Phoenix project. Who were the Phoenix project? Ah, a lot of people, right. Third way, experimenting is important. If you are building something because you cannot buy it in a store. You are building it because you want something that fits your customer in the best way. So you have to experiment to reach that particular product. About optionality. You might take your phone now and you might start your LinkedIn app and you might scan this particular barcode and then you get transferred to my LinkedIn page. But that's optional. You don't have to do that. The point is, the potential upside of a connection in LinkedIn is probably much higher than the potentially downside. Even further, maybe you also know this feature. If you go to that particular pictogram in the lower half of your, on the bottom of your screen in your LinkedIn app, you can click on that particular pictogram, and then disappears. And if you click that, then disappears. And if you click that, then disappears. And that. Everyone in this room who is on that particular page right now in his LinkedIn app will see all the other people in this room who are also on that particular page in their LinkedIn app. And so you could instantly connect to people in this room. But you don't have to. It's an option. But the point is, so that was actually, where is everyone? But the option is, I was talking about the potential upside of experimenting. There is a tricky part in it, because you also see that there are some, on the lower part, there are some potential negative changes in value. For instance, when we talk about a connection, or when we talk about an option, or when we talk about starting a company, that could also have a negative change in value. But the point is that a large positive change in value only happens. So this situation, only small negative and large positive, only happens when you are anti-fragile. When you are anti-fragile, that might happen. When you are fragile, this might happen. Which means actually that when you are experimenting within your system or in your organization, then the potentially negative changes in value are higher, larger, than the potentially positive changes in value. So then it's actually dangerous to experiment. So if you want to experiment, you have to make sure first whether you are fragile or anti-fragile. So suppose you conclude that you are fragile, then you would actually want to get rid of that potentially negative change in value. And one of the things to do that is via negativa. And via negativa, normally if we take measures, we add something. And via negativa will actually says you remove things, you take out things, you reduce things. Like handoffs. Who is familiar with Robert mentioned the video this in the beginning of the afternoon. Who's familiar with the Spotify video? A few hands, indeed. I can recommend the Spotify video to learn from it, especially because of the first two things. Handoffs between teams, that is actually organizational debt. And politics and fear and ego, also mentioned in that particular video, are also organizational debt. We will get back to that, but organizational debt is very dangerous in your organization when you start experimenting, because then you know you are fragile. So the potentially large negative changes in value might be great. And the other one, the last one, is technical debt. You also should get rid of technical debt. And this is one of the best, I think the best definition that ever has been given for technical debt by Gene Kim. Technical debt is what you feel the next time you want to make a change. I was wondering, who is familiar with technical debt? I would say almost anybody. Who has a manager who is familiar with technical debt? And who has a manager who supports you in getting rid of technical debt? And then we go down to about two, three, four hands, I guess. Yeah. I can recommend this particular article here at the bottom, Producing Milk or Shoveling Dirt. Brian Turnissen, he's actually talking about the four-color backlog. He says every organization has to deal with four colors in his backlog. But your customers will only ask for blue, and blue is adding features, and they will ask for yellow, and yellow is resolving defects. That's actually the only thing that your customers are asking for. But there are two other colors. Red is getting rid of technical debt, and green is the improvement backlog, like test automation. If you are only applying what your customer is asking for, you get this IKEA mix, yellow and blue. And if this were six sprints, then you can see that from the fifth and the sixth sprint, you are drowning in defects. So you have to add red and green. Red and green, technical debt reduction and improvements to manage that yellow down again and to make room for the blue features again. But you can imagine that you have to bite the bullet then, because if you already reach the stage of sprint 5 or sprint 6 and you start adding red and green on top of the yellow part, then there will be no blue left. We even got a term for that, refactoring sprint. That's what it is. And maybe you have to do more than one refactoring sprint to get that yellow down again. But the whole point is, and there is in this article, there's a lot of extra information about this. It helped me a lot to address the technical debt issue at management level and even at board level. Because technical debt is very important, and it also makes you very fragile. That's the reason that I'm mentioning it now. We were talking about the aspects of anti-fragility, and there's a last one, and that's transferring fragility. If you read this definition, one party has the downside, and the other party another party has the upside. You can imagine that it would maybe have something to do with dev and ops. And if you click dev and ops together, they have actually skin in the game. They have skin in each other's games. That is one of the terms that Taleb uses in his book. You want to have people in a team having skin in each other's game. A person has something to lose in a given situation. And where is that skin in the game missing? Skin in the game missing is with silos. Taleb also wrote a book, a particular book, just about this aspect of interoperability, skin in the game. And so in silos, you can say that dev has no skin in the ops game. Ops has no skin in the dev game. And that's the reason that you become fragile because of that aspect. The sole effect of that you do something within the development team that's bad for the ops guys or girls, and you don't care. So you could say that silos are fragilizers. Also, another point where skin is missing is projects. Projects, they miss the skin in the ops game, because normally projects only take into account the initial costs compared to the benefits and not the operational costs. And sometimes, of course, this is not the real situation, but you want really to start that particular project, so you just carve out the operational costs. So you can also say that projects are fragilizers because they have no skin in the ops game. And the last one, skin in the game is also missing with top management, top down management, or actually top management. This text is directly from the book of Taleb. So this is actually the way he writes. It's easier to micro bullshit than to micro bullshit. And that's correct, I would say. And bureaucracy is something that you put between the management layer and something that happens deep down in the organization where the work is done. And there's another writer, David Marquet. He wrote a book about it. Who's familiar with this book, The Turn the Ship Around? Yeah, quite some hands. And what David Marquet says, he says, you should push authority to the information level. So the level where the information is, let them those people on that level where that information is, let them decide for themselves. Normally, you would say, okay, there is an issue at this particular level, and then all the information is going up to the top of the organization, decision is made, and then it propels down, and then the action is executed at that particular level. But that takes too much time. And David Marquet, he was a captain at a nuclear submarine, and a nuclear submarine is what he calls a high-stress environment. But most of you are nowadays also in organizations that are high-stress environments. Sometimes you have to make decisions very fast on a particular level. And in that case, you want to push authority to the information level. So you want to decentralize decision-making. And of course, it's important that people at that particular level that they are technically competent and they have organizational clarity and they understand priorities, but most of those people are just highly educated and they are perfectly capable to take the particular decisions. There's even a decision table which has been introduced by Scaled Agile, which actually says that only centralized decisions that are infrequent, long-lasting, and provide significant economies of scale. And all the other things, those are frequent, time-critical, and require local information, in all those cases, decentralize them. That means that in most cases, some organizations, that 80-85% of all the decisions should be decentralized. No more micromanagement anymore, because it makes you slow and it makes you fragile, because decisions are made on a level where the information might not be present. So you could also say that top-down managers, management, are also fragilizers. Actually, all these things, all these situations where skin in the game is missing, all boil down to this particular picture. Are you in the same team or not? So, if it is a project or it is dev and ops or it is top-down management, so it's actually, it all boils down to this. So, we just discovered that to get more anti-fragile, you should reduce technical debt, you should do continuous deployment, and you should decentralize decision-making. What else? Well, we have to refer to this particular baby, this inoculation, because anti-fragility and also the chaos monkey, you can relate that to inoculation. And this baby, you can see that it sees for the very first time in his life a needle, because otherwise it would respond differently, I think. And if you're talking about an inoculation, you give a baby or a system or an organization a very slow dose of something. And then it becomes stronger, it builds immunity, it becomes stronger. And if you would give it a large dose, it would die, or the system would collapse, or the organization would stop. So a very good example of this is, for instance, the canary release. And you add a very small dose of users to the system. So a canary release is actually a very good example of that. Or maybe A/B testing, which facilitates actually small experiments to a system, and it is also reducing risk by, again, low doses. You're only changing a little bit. Also, anti-fragile is microservices, because you reduce a very big decision to a large number of small decisions, and you hope that they are all upside, and if they aren't, then you just rewrite them to make them upside again. So actually, a lot of small decisions is more anti-fragile than one big decision. So smaller decisions, decentralized decisions, is better than big decisions on a top level. And that also relates to another one, and that's economies of scale. Economies of scale, milk is cheapest in big cartons. That's not the case for software. Software is cheapest in lots of small cartons. And that's actually what we are doing right now, also with microservices, of course, but also in the way we actually work with our teams these days. So you could actually say that software development does not have economies of scale. It has actually this economies of scale. So you have to take that into account, because if you're scaling up, you also become more fragile. Another one is auto-scaling. It's programmed to respond to change automatically. So that makes you more anti-fragile, because changes who go in a wrong direction, think of the chaos monkey again, they are picked up and can be dealt with by auto-scaling. If you have to answer this particular question, would you focus on the mean time between failure, or would you rather focus on the mean time to repair? If I would ask you, what would you answer? Mean time to repair. Yeah. And what about your company and your users and your customers? What would they answer? In most cases, they say, oh, well, I just want a system that always works. So I want the mean time between failure to become very high, and the mean time to repair, well, I don't care about that actually. Actually, they should care about that, because if something breaks down, you want to repair it very fast, of course. So actually, the guru in that particular era, John Allspaugh, he says, anti-fragile systems assume that failure will happen. It will happen in the end, eventually. And he says, the focus on mean time between failures should only be the case for space hardware, because when you launched something, it's very hard to maintain something in space. And when you have embedded some medical device in your chest, you also want it to work flawlessly for a very long time. So in that case, mean time between failure. And with all the other stuff that most of us are building, you should focus on the mean time to repair. It also makes you more anti-fragile. So we could say that we can add microservices, we can add A/B testing, auto-scaling, focus on MTTR, and the canary releases where I started with. We already talked about the via negativa and that particular two things that were related to organizational depth. And actually, I go back to this one, because there's actually, if you look at this list of things that you can do to become more anti-fragile, there's even a bigger problem. And that bigger problem is actually organizational depth. And I left it blank in the bottom part of the screen, because that is actually our deepest problem. And the problem that we don't see in most cases. So when we are talking about handoffs between teams, and we are talking about politics and about fear and about ego, that's all organizational depth, and it makes us fragile. So when you look at this particular organizational chart, you don't see any value streams in this. You don't see how your products or services are built. This organizational schema is not linked to what you are actually doing in your work. And then I also come back to Conway. Robert mentioned that earlier this afternoon. So you could say that you could be blocked by Conway's law, which actually says that if you are building a system with four departments, that system will have four parts, actually. You will see your organization resembled in your system. That's actually what Conway says. So you could be blocked by Conway's law, but you can also leverage Conway's law. You can also say, okay, if that is the case, then I could also optimize my organization and make it more value stream-like, like, for instance, Amazon and Google did. And after I've done that, I actually got rid of that particular organizational debt, then in that case, I leverage Conway's law, because I know that it will hold me back. And Conway, Conway's law is from 1968. We have even an older law from Taylor, the four principles of scientific management. He published this in 1911. But if you read this, just ask you to read these four principles, then you have to conclude that most of the things that are in these four principles are still pretty much the case in our modern work environment. Right? Yeah. So we're trying to manage our organizations with some principles that are more than 100 years old. And that's actually also what Carlota Perez says. She actually derived this great searches of development from Kondratiev, who came as the first person with this theory. But she actually says that we are in the ICT revolution right now. It actually started in 1971, because in 1971 we had a lot of small developments, technological developments that eventually led to this particular ICT revolution. And we right now we are actually in a turning point, but we are still, most companies are still managing this whole ICT revolution in a way that is derived from the last revolution, so 1911 Taylor. I could also recommend this particular book written by Mick Kirsten, who's familiar with this book. I see two hands. Okay. Mick Kirsten, he actually, in this book, he actually says that you should stop with software projects, and you should manage your organization in a more product management way. He actually says that, and then I come back to that organizational debt, organizational charts and enterprise architecture are unable to support what you need these days. And the majority of the world's organizations, it will appear that they are unable to make their digital transformation successful. Actually, it just won't work after a lot of trying. And he actually says that value stream networks are actually the new infrastructure for innovation. So you, in the end, you would like to see in your organizational chart also your value streams. You would like to see how your organization is actually producing value. But that actually means, and that's quite a big change in most organizations, that you have to replace your project-oriented management, and you have to replace your cost center budgeting. So I will get a lot of discussions with control, and I will have to replace my original organizational chart, which also means a lot of management transfers and a lot of management reduction in an organization. And he also talks about four colors, slightly different from the one I already told you about. This is actually is talking about features and defects and risks and depths. And that's also what you actually see is when you have some months in which you are deploying a lot of features, and you're getting rid of a lot of defects, you can only contribute not that many effort to the blue and the orange. So you don't do anything about your depths and about your risks. And later on, from May, June, July, then you can see that you are increasing your blue effort and your orange effort again. So this is actually a zero-sum game. Just like in the other one, and the other four colors, that the four-color backlog that I already mentioned, this is something that you can show again to your management to make them aware of the fact that you can. It's not a feature world in a defect world alone. There are other colors you have to take into account to make sure that what you're doing is sustainable. One last point that I would like to share with you. This is the nine square model. Who is familiar with the nine square model? Nobody, right? Or was there a hand? No. Nine square model actually says, well, we have strategic, technical, and operational level, and we have on the left hand we have the business, on the right hand we have technology, and in the middle there's an information management column, and that's actually, for instance, business analysis is maybe, and information managers are actually roles that are working in that particular middle column to make sure that technology and business can communicate with each other. If you ask people to place DevOps in this particular 9-square model, what do you think they say? Where will DevOps pop up? Yeah, on the bottom line, and of course, on the right, the bottom right, because DevOps is something operational and it's something technical. So exactly that's where you will see it. But of course, the DevOps teams, they want to connect with their businesses, and they also want to connect with other DevOps teams. So they have to make a tactical link to the rest of the organization. And the resulting force is towards the upper left. So there is actually a push towards the middle. And when you have smart people working in your board of directors, they realize how important IT is, and they will start to pull. So the push and the pull really align. And there's something else, because in what you can especially see in like banks or insurance companies or travel agencies, the lower left part of this particular model is getting empty. Operational business people, like in a bank or an insurance company or a travel agency, they are not there anymore, because all their work actually gets automated. And that's why also a lot of managers are being reduced. So you can actually say that the lower left and the middle left square are actually being reduced. And the same actually happens for the right part of this model, because DevOps teams are very autonomous. So this actually says you don't have to lecture your birds how to fly. And that's what you see also in DevOps organizations, that the management in the technology column is also reduced. So the resulting form is actually a high heel. And that's why they call this a high heel model, where the company is actually leaning with its full weight on the DevOps teams, and it has a direct connection with the board of directors in the organization. This was my last slide. Any questions?
Thank you, Ian.
Any questions? Yes. We will have to wait for the microphone.
You said earlier that some organization leverage conveys law. So
yeah.
Can you give example how they do it?
Normally what Conway says, okay, it's a given this is your organization, and it is not optimized and it is blocking you because your system is only as smart as your organization is organized. But what you can do is getting rid of silos, because getting rid of silos is one of the best ways to make that value stream visible and to make that value stream work. And after that, you're actually leveraging that, because the organization is not an obstacle anymore for building that smarter system. Did I answer your question?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Any other questions?
We are only 50 minutes from the cocktail dinner, I know.
Yeah.
But no. Anyhow, I'm more than happy to answer any question in the remaining hour that I will, or 2 hours that I will be here, and I will also be here tomorrow. So just ask me, and I we'll have a good discussion, I guess.
Okay, thank you very much, Jan.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. Great.